Very good evening to all of you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for your presence here today for this very important lecture on techno-economic analysis of the failure of the urea plant, which was established in 1979 and subsequently shut down in 1985. Now, the reason why we chose this title is because there have been many large numbers of failures of various government investments, chemical plants as well as various other projects. And one of the reasons, not just one, there are many reasons. I think the most important reasons are the analysis of demand, supply, cost of production, selling price, profit. That equation is not satisfied in most of these cases. So if you look at some of the old projects, there are many projects which were established by the government, spending millions and millions of rupees, but subsequently had to be closed down. Good examples are Higurana sugar factory, China Bay Pulmudi mineral sand plants, right? And also subsequently Kanthale paper plant, Abilivitia paper plant, right? And the urea plant, and recently the Hambantota harbor, right? Martel airport, Suryama cricket grounds, right? All these are massive public investments, spending billions of rupees of public money, right? On personal glorification kinds of ventures, right? Now, I am an engineer with 37 years of experience. I passed out in 1979, and I am actually a professor in the Department of Chemical and Process Engineering. I was in the industry for 12 years. My friend Dhammika Welheng and I were together in the same batch. Then when it came to urea plant, I also went there, and but I didn't join the urea plant. I went for some other institution. But what we could see is that most of these government institutions have been absolute failures, right? The reasons are very important. No, unfortunately, what happens is we fail in one project, but without analyzing the reasons for that project, we go on another project and likewise keep on doing it. And in most of these cases, what we have seen is that these are politically oriented, politically motivated projects. Where, for example, Higurana sugar factory, the government of the day wanted to establish the biggest sugar factory in Southeast Asia, right? And they spent money and established it, but they didn't look at sugarcane cultivation. So finally, after establishing the sugar manufacturing plant, they found that there were no sugarcane, right? So 9 months of the year the plant was closed because they had sugarcane only for 3 months, right? So, and for example, recently we had these new projects, right? They are without having any kind of agreements to get ships to the harbor. They would go and put a harbor without having any kind of agreements to have airplanes. They go and put a airport, right? Without looking at the feasibility of putting up a cricket ground, right? They go and put a cricket ground. And good example is, recently now, we are very senior people, right? And all our people, all my batchmates are AGMs, DGMs of CEB, water board and various places. And about 2 years back, we had our 35th anniversary, right? So we wanted to, and all our friends from various parts of the world came to Sri Lanka, and we want to go and have a look at some of these projects which have been put up in the south, right? So we went. And we went to the harbour, we found that there were no buildings, there were no ships, right? Then we went to the airport, we found that it was absolutely kind of isolated place where there wasn't even a boutique to have a plane tea, right? Then we went to Suryama, and we were appalled by the, it was run by the army, right? And when we spoke to them, they said every day to keep the grass alive, they had to put 800,000 litres of water. 400,000 litres of water in the morning, 400,000 litres of water in the evening, just to keep the grass alive, right? Whereas the people in that area don't have water for cultivation, they don't have water to drink. So just to have glorification of public, you know, various politicians, we have done these, and finally the entire country has lost. The worst part is now, since we have got these, if you have your own money like the Middle East, you can say my car, my petrol. I had money, I spent, it is a loss, no problem. I lose, right? But here, right, public money, each and every, even a beggar is, has to repay, right? So in that sense, I think this lecture is very important. And actually, I invited a large number of University of Moratuwa undergraduates and lecturers and so on to come for this, because in the future there are people who will be designing various plants, and when they at the time of design, they should look at all these aspects, right? Otherwise, it will be another set of failures in the future. So we are very happy to have Engineer C.Eng, a very, very senior chemical engineer, I think pioneer, we were in the second batch, and he has worked in large number of very, very important companies, Unilever, Shell Gas, Litrogas, LAUGFS, and even the regional manager for environmental, environment, health and safety, that is safety, health and environment, for Unilever, entire region including Israel, and Shell Gas again, the region, and now he is the general manager of SHE, that is safety, health and environment of LAUGFS. He was the ammonia plant manager when it was put up at the beginning, from the commissioning to the shutdown, he was there. And we also have engineer Heshan De Silva, who again, right, not so senior, but has about 20 years of experience in the field of chemical engineering. He was also working at Unilever and several important institutions, and currently is the engineering manager of LAUGFS. And these two gentlemen have a lot of experience. And in fact, we wanted a bigger audience so that they could get the message, especially the young people who will be taking over from the senior people and, you know, taking the country forward into the next, say, million, maybe another 50, 60 years. But unfortunately, they have not come here. But anyway, although we are, and personally as the chairman of the chemical engineering section, and sad to have a small audience and also not having university people, yet I think we'll be able to do a good job today, and I will request engineer Dhammika Welheng to start. He will take about 30 minutes, and then we will have engineer Heshan De Silva, who is the person who did the real analysis, techno-economic analysis of the failure, right? Over to Dhammika. And Dhammika, by the way, is graduated in 1979, and as I mentioned, he has held a large number of very, very senior posts. And I think we are all fortunate to have a very senior person like Dhammika to, you know, give a lecture today. Thanks.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Today the presentation is divided into two sections. One is about ammonia production. The second part will be about the analysis, technical and economical analysis of the failure of the ammonia urea project. First of all, I think we have to get to know what ammonia, what urea, and how these things are manufactured. So the process, it is important to understand the process. Let us start with the significance of ammonia. What is ammonia and why it is so significant? I will start with why ammonia is made out of nitrogen, 46% nitrogen in ammonia. Rather urea, ammonia is a nitrogen hydrogen combination. So what is important is where the nitrogen is produced within the earth, and how it is going to the atmosphere, and how it comes back from the atmosphere to the earth. So so this is called the nitrogen cycle, and I think you must have gone through the nitrogen cycle in your school days. Generally, nitrogen is available in the atmosphere. In the ground, the nitrogen is available in nitrates form of nitrates. So these nitrates can be absorbed by plants, and the plants give their products, crops, then crops eaten by the animals, and the animals then excrete, and like that it goes into cycles. Whatever goes out into the atmosphere will not come back. Very little amount comes back through the nitrogen fixation by bacteria, but that is not a very significant process, because if you look at the amount of nitrogen required by the human beings for their food intake, it is not absorbed from atmosphere to the earth. So it is important to get the ammonia, get the nitrogen from the atmosphere to the earth. So that is called nitrogen fixation. Let us see what methods are available for nitrogen fixation. Because you know, if you go on like this without getting nitrogen from the atmosphere to the earth, then earth crust will be depleted with nitrogen. These are a few facts. Nitrogen is the most abundant gas in the atmosphere. It has 78%. The balance is oxygen and inert gases. Then nitrogen is an essential component in our proteins and food, and also the DNA, RNA and chlorophyll, even in foods and the trees, the chlorophyll, and this is how the nitrogen cycle within the earth's crust takes place. If you look at the nitrogen cycle within the body, also there is a nitrogen cycle. Actually the nitrogen cycle, the nitrogen intake will be converted to amino acids. So amino acids is very important for people, not only people, all their lives, and ultimately this will produce energy in the form of glucose and lipids, and ultimately excreted as urea. So urea, if you are talking of urea, urea is part of the human beings. Let us look at nitrogen fixation, how nitrogen can be fixed from atmosphere. There were a lot of research work done because you know, people in the 1980s, they realized that if you go on like this, all the nitrogen will be depleting in the earth crust unless you fix nitrogen from the atmosphere. So there were research done, and one of the scientists was the Heber. Fritz Heber, he did some work, and ultimately he arrived at a process called Heber process. This is the nitrogen, atmospheric nitrogen combined with hydrogen to fix ammonia. But this is, this process is very high temperature and high pressure with certain catalyst, ion catalyst. Somehow he managed to do laboratory scale trials. But the problem is, the pressure is the problem. The pressure was 200 atmospheres. So Heber could not achieve this, because Heber is a chemist, he could not achieve this pressure with this apparatus. So ultimately he got the help, Heber is from Germany, he got the help of an engineer to manufacture a pressure vessel, to fabricate a pressure vessel for this purpose, to stand 200 atmospheres pressure. So ultimately, the Karl Bosch, he was an engineer with chemical background from the BASF company, volunteered to help Heber. He developed and designed a pressure vessel, and this pressure vessel was able to bring the pressure up to 200 psi, 200 bars. So therefore, actually Heber and Bosch, Karl Bosch and Fritz Heber, these two people got together and invented this process. That is why the process is called Heber-Bosch process of nitrogen fixation. So nitrogen is combined with hydrogen to produce ammonia with high pressure and high temperature with catalyst. The catalyst is ion catalyst. With the Heber-Bosch process, development of the Heber-Bosch process, with this ammonia, various other products were developed. Now for instance, ammonia was converted to urea, ammonia was converted to nitric acid, then nitric acid was converted to ammonium nitrate, then using phosphorus rock, phosphate rock, ammonium phosphates, DAP, all these calcium nitrate, all these fertilizers were produced using this process. Now all these plants are actually small plants. Ammonia plant is the initial base plant, but if you have the ammonia base plant, then it can supply ammonia to urea, ammonium nitrate, calcium nitrate, NPK, all these plants. Now this is the process in all chemical complexes, or rather fertilizer complexes. Fertilizer complexes, you have a base plant, the base plant is producing ammonia, and it supplies ammonia to other plants with other fertilizers. So this is how the fertilizer complexes come. ammonia plant alone cannot work because it has to supply ammonia to some other plant. So urea, ammonia and urea combination will not work. Ammonia and ammonia nitrate will not work. You must have all these things together. And also, if there is phosphate rock, it is better to have phosphate fertilizers as well. And if you have sulfur from refineries, then you can have sulfur compounds like ammonium sulfate. Out of these, ammonium nitrate, it's an explosive. So they found that if you keep ammonium nitrate, it explodes. With the development of this process, Haber process, in 1913, that is before the World War, they used this for mass production of fertilizers. So with the production, mass production fertilizers, they were able to cultivate large extents of land. So they cultivated all the land and this created vegetable protein for the entire population. So they managed to get protein out of nitrogen in the atmosphere. And also they produced animal feed using vegetables, and ultimately they got the meat. And even urea was used as directly as the feed for cows, and also urea was mixed, urea molasses was used for directly for feeding cows. This is straw, urea mixed with straw, cow feed, and this is a packet of urea meant for feeding cows, cattle feed. So like that, you know, they have developed ways and means for the production of vegetables and meat. With this, the meat production went up. Meat production went up, and even other crops went up. Production of other crops went up. And if you look at this, you can see this is the population growth, and this is this line, dotted line is world population growth without Haber-Bosch process. If Haber-Bosch process was not there, the population growth would have been here, because there was no protein production in the world. Because of the Haber-Bosch process, the population growth has come up like this. So this graph shows that if there were no Haber-Bosch process, if these people did not invent the ammonia production and fixation, even the population will not grow at this level. Now this shows that the cultivable land or arable land is limiting, because you know we are having development projects. Because of that, the area required for cultivation is diminishing. If you look at the total extent of land, the total extent of land is diminishing. Therefore, the area given for cultivation is limited. Therefore, we have to get maximum output with the amount of area. Like for acre, you have to get the maximum amount of rice or whatever it is, and out of that meat and all that with the amount of land. So land is limited. Therefore, it is important that with the small amount of land, you have to get more. Therefore, you can't wait until the natural nitrogen fixation, like, you know, lightning. Lightning gives a little amount of nitrogen fixation, but that is not enough. Then with the ammonia converted to nitric acid, they produce nitroglycerin, nitrocellulose, dynamite, gelignite, nitrotoluene, C4, explosive. These are the explosives used in wars. So they managed to produce explosives using ammonia, because ammonia can be easily converted to nitric acid by oxidation, simple oxidation process. So that also helped the world because of the Second World War. In the Second World War, what happened was sea transport of all food and ammunition stopped. When sea transport stopped, the countries which had the Haber-Bosch process managed to maintain their population, managed to maintain their food production, and also their ammunition and explosives. But other countries which didn't have, and they the other countries who relied on external supplies could not survive, and or otherwise they were at the mercy of other countries like big powers. So certain people like Germany is the first one to invent the Haber Bosch process. They attacked even Russia, and Chile nitrate, the nitrate in Chile, was the supply for America. And these people were big forces. Ultimately, in the First World War, those people who had nitrates had the powers, and others had to surrender. All the government with the First World War, the learnings from the First World War, all the governments started researching for ammonia production and nitrate fertilizers and nitrogen for ammunition. Scientists and engineers, they were given support by the government for nitrogen industry. So the nitrogen industry developed because of this. And ultimately, nitrogen industry developed with ammonia plant, a central ammonia plant, urea, ammonia, all these things were manufactured. At the same time, these things also were manufactured. Now, in 1980, I went to Russia. I saw in most of these manufacturing plants, they had a section for explosives, another section for agriculture. During wartime, they closed the agriculture and go for explosives. During peacetime, they go for always they can, you know, they can survive whatever, the whether it is peace or war, they can survive because they can do whatever it is. Because in Russia, actually, we were not shown this area. We were shown only the agricultural area or the urea production, because we were not shown, because it was kept as a secret at that time, because it was in 1980 during USSR time. Now USSR is no more there. Then manufacturing of ammonia. Let us look at manufacturing of ammonia. To manufacture ammonia, you need nitrogen and hydrogen. The Haber Bosch process. Nitrogen comes from atmosphere, because that is called nitrogen fixation. Hydrogen comes from water. But how do you get hydrogen from water and atmospheric nitrogen? Initially, the process was atmospheric nitrogen was taken through produced through the Linde process, that is partial fractionation of liquefied air. Then hydrogen was produced by electrolysis. Now this is very expensive, because when you produce hydrogen by electrolysis, you have to vent the rest of the gases, because you get only hydrogen, you have to vent the oxygen. Linde process, once you get the nitrogen, you have to vent the oxygen, unless you have you find some use of oxygen. And also you get very pure nitrogen and very pure hydrogen, which is not required for fertilizer grade. Therefore, this cost was not bearable for fertilizer production. So scientists did some research to find out what we can do to get nitrogen and hydrogen. Ultimately, at this moment, during this period, they were having the town gas. They used town gas for this purpose. Town gas was produced. Town gas was produced using carbon, using coal. Actually, certain countries, depending on the availability, they used coke. Coke is the residue of coal and charcoal. Whatever the carbon, when reacted with steam, produced hydrogen and carbon monoxide. So this is a very economical process, because you react steam and carbon. Carbon comes from coke or charcoal. Or coal. Coal can be distilled. Now, when you have coal, what they do is they use the energy of the coal to boil water, because you need steam. When the energy is used for boiling water, the residue is coke. The coke is produced. Coke is converted to get hydrogen. So this is the initial process. And at this during this period, all the countries had the town gas. So town gas was abundant, and it is called water gas. This process was called water gas. This is the way during that period the gas lines were supplied, the gas pipes were supplied to the towns. Then if you add another step to this steam carbon process, if you add the what is called shift reaction, water gas shift reaction, then the shift reaction will convert further water into hydrogen. So if you combine these both the steps, you will get carbon converted to ultimately hydrogen and carbon dioxide. So this is the water gas reaction. This is the initial process of producing hydrogen. But this town gas system was replaced by hydrocarbons when hydrocarbons were available. When hydrocarbons were available, this carbon was replaced by hydrocarbon. You can use any hydrocarbon, methane, ethane, propane, butane, whatever it is, for this carbon. So therefore, hydrocarbon replaced this carbon, and ultimately it became hydrocarbon reforming. When you have hydrocarbon with water reacting with water, it is called hydrocarbon reforming. And hydrocarbon reacts with water to produce the same reaction. The additional hydrogen is there in the carbon. Now when you react carbon with water, you get the same reaction, but with hydrocarbon you get additional hydrogen. So your purpose is to produce hydrogen. So ultimately, if you take methane in the reforming process produces carbon dioxide and hydrogen. So hydrogen is important. But now where does the air come from? Now you need nitrogen. Now what they did was they injected air, so that air burnt in this, because this is flammable atmosphere. When you inject air, air burns and nitrogen is precipitated, or nitrogen is an inert gas, nitrogen remains within the mixture. So they injected air into this. This is called primary reforming without air, before injecting air. And steam and methane is converted through a catalyst tube, through this set of catalyst tubes at this temperature of 500, and ultimately you get methane, 10% methane. Then the secondary reforming, you inject air. When you inject air to the partly converted hydrocarbon, the reaction completes. And with the nitrogen, added nitrogen, you get nitrogen in the mixture. So you have hydrogen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide in the mixture. So after this process, it is a matter of cleaning. Cleaning means this will go through a absorber. Absorber means alkaline solution. It will be scrubbed through alkaline solution. It can be potassium carbonate, diethanolamine, or any solution. Carbon dioxide is absorbed. Of course, this carbon dioxide, even though it is absorbed in the alkaline solution, in a stripper it can be recovered. So the same solution can be used when you take the carbon dioxide out. That carbon dioxide can be used for urea production if you have a urea plant along with the ammonia. So ultimately the entire process is called, now the process we had in Sri Lanka was ICA, naphtha reforming process, because the hydrocarbon selected was naphtha. So based on naphtha, now if you select naphtha, naphtha has to be desulfurized first. Then after the desulfurization, it has to go to the primary reformer. With the primary reformer, you get the conversion, part conversion. Then the second reformer, air is added. When air is added, air is partly burned, nitrogen is added into the system. So you have nitrogen, hydrogen, carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide. In the ship conversion, you have high temperature ship conversion and low temperature ship conversion. This is a nickel catalyst. High temperature ship conversion is iron catalyst. Low temperature ship conversion is a copper catalyst. With these temperatures, these are exothermic reactions, and you can generate, even after this, there are waste heat boilers. You can generate steam, all these processes, because these are exothermic reactions. Then after that, water is separated. Then it went through, the gases are scrubbed through absorber, and these absorber stripper, there is a cycle. From the stripper, you get carbon dioxide. Again, the solution is sent back. It is a potassium carbonate solution with some diethanolamine. And ultimately, you will get a mixture here with carbon dioxide removed. What, after removing carbon dioxide, now carbon monoxide is converted to carbon dioxide in the chip conversion. Ultimately, you get nitrogen and hydrogen in the ratio you want. To adjust the ratio of nitrogen and hydrogen 1:3, what you want to do is to adjust this air. So this air is sent into the system using a process compressor, this centrifugal compressor. You can adjust the speed of the compressor and adjust the nitrogen hydrogen ratio. Nitrogen hydrogen ratio is to be 1:3. So with this nitrogen hydrogen ratio, now what you get out of this is only nitrogen hydrogen, but there will be slight amount of nitrogen carbon oxides and carbon monoxide. There is a section called methanation. In the methanation section, you remove all that because you convert it to methane. Ultimately, it goes into the loop, the ammonia conversion loop. This ammonia converter. Ammonia converter is a loop. In this loop, once ammonia is converted with this pressure and temperature, it goes through
a refrigeration system, so that it will be cooled to minus 33. At minus 33, ammonia is liquefied and the gas which is not reacted will be sent back to the converter. So it is a it is called synthesis gas circulation system. So this synthesis gas circulation system, you can circulate many times so that you will, as long as you get the liquid from here. So this ammonia liquefaction process is using an ammonia refrigeration cycle. You have refrigeration compressor to drive this ammonia refrigeration cycle. Then after separation, you get ammonia, and ammonia is stored in a storage tank. And so tail gases are again used. If tail gases contain methane and hydrogen, that can be used for lighting these burners in the furnace. So if you look at this, there are exothermic reactions. The catalytic conversion, ammonia conversion, is a very highly exothermic reaction, and the ship conversion exothermic reaction, methanation exothermic reaction, all these things are exothermic reactions. Now if you look at the exothermic reactions, the heat generated is converted to steam. Now what is generated? The steam is generated at high pressure, so that the efficiency is very high. Steam is generated at 105 bars, that is about 1500 psi. So 1500 psi, if you generate steam, that steam drum has to be has to have a thickness of about 8 inches thick wall. So that means that system, including the furnace, will have to be heated for 7 days for startup and shutting down 7 days, because you know the thickness is so high that you can't immediately shut down and start up. Therefore all these pumps and compressors in this system should be turbine, because turbines will not stop immediately. You can maintain the turbine steam pressure and turbines can be driven. Ammonia synthesis compressor, refrigeration compressor, carbon dioxide compressor, if carbon dioxide is sent to the urea plant, and air compressor. All these compressors are centrifugal compressors driven by turbines. So what is important is, in this process the exothermic heat is generated and utilized to produce steam, and the steam drives the turbines, and therefore without electricity this plant can run, because it is self-sufficient with energy. There is no electricity required for this plant to run, because with this steam generated with this plant, a 6 megawatt generator is driven by the steam. Therefore that electricity is enough to run the electrical components, control systems, instruments and lighting. Therefore the entire system without electricity, without depending on CEB, this plant can run. Of course, you know, when there is a shutdown, the generator can run and export electricity to CEB. So this is a very complex plant by nature, because it has developed over the years, and ultimately ICEI developed this process so that the efficiency is maximum utilized. So this is the most efficient version of the ammonia plants. And ammonia plants generally take about 7 days to start up and about 7 days to shut down. Therefore these plants cannot be stopped and started as you want. And if there is a production interruption, then there will be a problem, because production should not be interrupted. That is why these plants cannot run with a single plant. Now if you look at this, ammonia plant cannot be stopped. Now this ammonia plant, if it cannot be stopped, it has to be coupled with many plants, urea, ammonium nitrate, like that. If urea plant stops, this should not stop. Ammonium nitrate plant should work. If ammonia nitrate plant stops, other plant should, because this plant should not be stopped, because this is a continuous plant. These all the equipment are designed to run without maintenance, without stopping. So actually this ammonia plant is the base plant, and these are called satellite plants. All these satellite plants are required to support the ammonia plant continuously running. And this part, of course, there was no government plan to produce or get ready for a war, because this was in 75. They didn't imagine that there was a need of or whether there is a need for a war. But ultimately they faced the war somehow. So this is the simple process. This can be used, you can use any raw material, even carbon, coke or LPG, LNG, whatever it is.
So hydrocarbon is, if you use hydrocarbon, you get additional hydrogen. Oils, you can use charcoal or coke. In fact, you know, the expansion process, the refinery expansion process, there was a plan to produce coke. The inventor is here, refinery expansion process. In the process, there was additional coke. So there is a way of, if you can manufacture ammonia, that coke can be utilized. And also, if there is anything like LPG or LNG, this can be produced because there is no specific requirement for specific hydrocarbon. Right, then urea. Urea, this is a stemicarbon process. Ammonia and carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is produced separately in the ammonia plant. So urea plant is it's a matter of mixing and reacting the ammonia with carbon dioxide. So this is the urea plant. This is a double crystallization, double crystallization process. That is the urea produced is separated by crystallization, and these crystals are washed. Because on the surface of the crystal, the biuret component is there. The biuret is a toxic substance that will be washed and separated and again melted. The urea is melted and again sent to the prill tower. So this is a double crystallization process. This is not a commercial type urea because this is manufactured, or the plant is designed to produce urea so that part of the urea goes to the manufacture of plastics. So urea, if you look at urea once prilled, it will be something like this. This is called carbamide. So carbamide is a chemical used for many plastics. So this plant was designed to manufacture plastics like urea, formaldehyde resins, urea formaldehyde resin, melamine, all these things were planned with the urea, because urea, the plant capacity is designed for the requirement of plastics. And all these things are produced from urea, melamine, then MDF. These MDF boards are produced by urea formaldehyde resin. This is the form refrigeration. You use this form packing for refrigeration. This is insulation. So this is how insulation. This is urea formaldehyde resin. All these switches and electrical components are produced using urea formaldehyde resin. So a lot of urea is going into the switches and electrical appliances, the melamine and the TF boards and the insulation packings, a lot of things. So therefore urea is going into, urea is not just a fertilizer, it's called carbamide. It's a chemical, starting chemical for plastics and also nylon 6. Actually, the government decided about nylon 6 and they had the plant, but the caprolactam plant was not in plan. So that was a mistake, because you know, you need a caprolactam plant to produce. From ammonia you can produce caprolactam and nylon 6. So nylon 6 was part of this project. So using Haber-Bosch process, you need to produce ammonia and then urea and all these things. This is how it is balanced. Right. This is the end of my presentation. I will take you through some pictures. I will show you some pictures of the ammonia urea complex which was in the in Sapukas Kanda. This complex was commissioned in 79 and 85 it was closed down. So these are the stripper towers, absorbers and strippers, and this ammonia, these are the ammonia converters. This structure is required to remove the catalyst basket. Inside there is a catalyst basket. To refill the catalyst, you need this height. This is the pre tower, urea pre tower, absorber and stripper. And this is the stream drum, horizontal stream drum. These are fuel tanks. This is the pre tower, ammonia converters and the heater. You have the furnace here. You can see the furnace with convection and all that recycles urea plant. Then here again you can see this is the steam drum and compressor house, urea tower, absorber and stripper. This is the compressor house, the furnace for heat up, startup heater for converter. These are again some sections of this plant. This is the ammonia storage tank. Ammonia storage tank is a double wall tank because the ammonia is refrigerated and maintained at minus 33. This is the cooling tower. It has about 6 and 7 cells. This is the refrigeration system where these are the chillers with high pressure system, because the refrigeration system is at high pressure, 150 bars. This is the condenser for turbines. The turbines vacuum condenser. So this is the vacuum condenser for the turbines. For high pressure steam generation, you need pure water. This is the demineralization plant for manufacturing demineralized water. This is the water intake. The water intake. Okay, that's the end of it. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, Professor S.A. is chairman of the Chemical and Process Engineering Sectional Committee. First of all, I kept two valuable gifts on the table to show my dear audience, because at the end of this session I'm going to give away two valuable gifts to you, right? So I hope you would be very keen to listen my presentation, right? These are, in fact, Noritake porcelain two sets, tea sets, right? So this is the question I will put forward first of all before I do my presentation. So please listen carefully and you should be able to find the answer at the end of the session, right? I hope you read the question. Okay. What is the most crucial factor that contributed to make the project a failure? This urea project failure. Okay. So I think in the first session, first half of the session, Engineer Welheng, Mr. Dhammika Welheng gave you a very deep understanding of what urea is and how the urea is formed and the history of ammonia and urea. So now I am going to tell you about the bad side of this story. Right. This is the event summary. In fact, I am going to tell you about the failure factors, what went wrong with this a marvelous project in Sri Lanka for us to learn a lesson and to use this knowledge for future projects. So this was in fact established the SFMC, that is State Fertilizer Manufacturing Corporation, in 1967, and feasibility report started in 1972, report submitted 73, and government cabinet approval came in 74, and contract awarded in January 1976, and the construction completed in August 1980. So it was started in 76 and completed in 1980. And performance guarantee test done in 1981, and they commenced commercial operations in January 1982, and they ceased the operations in July 1984, and in fact it was officially closed down in 1985, as Mr. Welheng revealed you. So it's a 12-year journey. 12 years passed. Okay. The investment. Typical investment for a urea plant is like this. For a 1,000 tons per day plant will cost us $43 million, and 1,500 TPD plant will cost 62 million, and 3,600 tons per day will cost us 600 million. And see, our plant is 1,000 tons per day plant, single line, $113 million. That is, but at the end of the project in 1984, total investment was $140 million, that equals to 3.4 billion Sri Lankan rupees. At that time, the conversion rate was 24.4. So we spent 140 million. Whereas in the world, if you do a research and see, it should be 43 million on average, right? Loss to the nation. We lost the capital investment. Mind you, this is the second largest project in Sri Lankan history, second to Mahaveli project. It's the second largest project, investment project. So we lost the capital investment, foreign debts. We ended up with foreign debts. We got six loans from ADB, from various world banks. Unemployment, foreign exchange loss, and subsidy burden. Still we have the subsidy burden on the government for on fertilizer. Of course, I think it's been removed. And agricultural development boom expected. We lost that. And we lost industrial development boom expected. As Mr. Engineer Dhammika Welheng showed you, fertilizer, this is one of the key element that a nation should have. To start with, to explore fertilizers, plastics, essential chemicals, like what he mentioned. So we lost the industrial development that we expected. Now I'm taking you through the factors that contributed to the failure, what I see personally as an engineer, what I how I analyze this. So economic plan sizing. During the period of 1970, the other regional countries have developed their production of urea fertilizer, starting from small scale plants. In fact, if you take Korea and India, for example, now our plant capacity, as I mentioned, 1,000 tons per day. So we can produce 330 tons per day, tons per annum, if the plant is work continuously smoothly, right? So capacity is one of the questions that I have. You see the scenario in Korea. They had 8 plants by 1988 urea plants. First plant started in 1961, which was 82,000 tons per annum plant, whereas we had 310,000 tons per annum plant. And also they had started with a 37,000 tons per annum plant, small plant. In 1976, Korea started a plant with capacity of 217,000 tons TPA. In the same time, Sri Lanka had 330,000 tons per annum. So in 76, the same time, we also started in 76, they also started 76. Korea operated old plants with or without modifications successfully. And we'll see what has happened in India. India had 10 plants in that time. In 70-80 era, they had 10 plants still in operation, right? With or without revamping and modifications. Maximum capacity was 181,000 tons per annum. And second largest producer in South Asia. India is the second largest urea producer in this region, in entire Asia. But their biggest plant was 181,000. They are making 2.8 million tons per annum. And Sri Lanka, the demand forecast is also a question to me. Whether they have done a correct demand forecast, right? And that has a bearing on the project viability. Forecasters, project proposal. And in fact, if you go through the statistics, it shows that we had to run this plan for 20 years under loss to come to the capacity supply demand equalization limit. Because you see, in 1984, when the plant was shut down, one plant was abandoned, that time the entire country's consumption was 83,000 something, whereas our plant capacity was 310,000. So what are you going to do with the excess? This much of excess annual urea imports from 1992 to 2002. See, what I want to show is, in 2002, see the annual entire country's imports is hardly 350,000, crossing the plant capacity. In 2002, how many years from 1976? This is annual use of urea in Sri Lanka from 1971 to 2002. In 1971, the consumption was hardly 100,000. And it has gone down by 1975. You will see the reason. And gradually it has been picked up. And by 1984, it was somewhere there. 1983, when the plant was shut down, it is less than 150. Urea imports today we are importing this much. 2012, 302,000, even less than the plant capacity. And raw material price. We talked about the plant capacity, now we're talking about the raw material price. The raw material was, as he explained, was the naphtha from our refinery. See, the naphtha, the price of urea had never gone up to $250 in the world market, our imported price. Even till 2000, the government paid the subsidy. Even with that, government paid subsidy for imported urea. the decision makers that time thought that they could have disappeared, they could have eliminated this subsidy, fertilizer subsidy, if the plant were in a success endeavor. That was that idea. Actually, that's just true. That's very reasonable objective that they had. And losses. Production cost ₹8,359 per metric ton of urea. And the dollar value is 342 that time. Whereas imported urea price was very much less than that. And depreciation, plant depreciation is 1,700. BTT, ₹240 per metric ton. And feedstock, that's naphtha price, is ₹4,850 per metric ton. That is, that amounts to $198. So naphtha price that time was $249 per metric ton from the CPC refinery. Because CPC price based on the world market price. CPC didn't issue this byproduct free of charge. It was costed at the world market price with all the import taxes also imposed on naphtha price. So, startup shutdown cost was very high, as he recommended, because this plant takes 6 days to start up. 6 days. Shutdown was like that. It's a very lengthy process. And it costs, even after commissioning, SFMC had lost 62 million for startup and shutdown, feedstock and fuel. Except other overheads like salaries, this and that. In only for feedstock and fuel, they lost 62 million that time. We are talking about, please remember, these numbers are that time numbers, not current numbers. 62 million rupees that time. And financial loss 1981, 1982, 1983, 3 years. This plant was operated for 3 years. Those are the losses. 500 million. Something like that. So this is operating history in 1983. January they ran 24 days, February only 1 day, March 7 days, April 19 days, May 8 days, June half a day, July 28 days. July of course a good month for this SFMC. And they have produced and they are running at 82% production rate. See why they couldn't run this plant continuously. It's a question, big problem. World market, urea external environment. Urea technology and urea marketing has had a drastic change in 1980 decade. In 1984, British Sulphur Corporation forecasted supply demand equilibrium. 1986, and new plants came. 1986-87. During the period, the import was price was US dollars 141. That time, the imported price was 141, whereas ex-factory cost of SFMC was $346 per ton. Therefore, they were unable to sell it to the international market. A comprehensive SWOT analysis would have been done prior to this. I have no idea what was there with the decision makers in terms of SWOT analysis. Environment change forecast would have been carried out in the project proposal time. Ammonia and urea prices, the world prices, are like this. So it, you will see from 1977 to 85 the prices are well below $200, whereas our price, our expected cost is 340 something. The crude oil price and urea price. Here what I want to tell you is there is a direct relationship between crude oil price and the urea price. Not only in Sri Lanka, entire world, that's the case. You see, from 1985, from 1983 to 2015, the crude oil price. In 1974, there was the crisis, oil embargo came in, right? Middle East crisis. That time, there's a hike, and then there's a drop, again there's a hike, and in 2008-09 there's the peak in the world, crude oil peak. And similarly, urea price had also a peak in that time. If you take, I have a lot more data to show, but it's not the time. I have from 1850 to today, the crude oil price and the urea price, there is a direct relationship between the crude oil and the urea, because naphtha, that time naphtha was the feedstock mostly. And this is the urea price in dollars. In present day prices, you see in 2016 the price is here, 2007-08 because of the crude oil it has gone up, and now it has dropping. It is dropping now. This is the project time. During the project time, the crude oil price, you see, is 74. There's a high because of this oil embargo. And then 79 onwards, when that is the time we commission this plant. There is a big hike, big jump in crude oil, right? Crude oil. So that has a direct, as I said, there's a direct impact on urea prices. So we dependent on naphtha producing our refinery. So refinery is pricing the naphtha based on the world crude oil prices. So you can imagine now naphtha price has gone up. This is a very unfortunate situation happened for the success of this plant. Even the commission time, there is a big hike in with the crude oil prices. So as the urea price, naphtha price, this is the naphtha price. During the same period, you see the hike. After 1978, there is a big hike, you see. So this is one of the key factors affected this project failure. Monthly averages of urea prices, during the near history, and current urea price is $177 per ton, today's dollars. So if you take back to 1976 price, the today's dollars 177, you can take back to discounted to 1976, see the price, which is now very, very cheap. Export market strategy. Because now the country's consumption that time 1984 was 83,000 metric tons per annum, whereas the plant capacity was 310,000 tons. So I'm sure they would have had a plan to export the excess. But unfortunately, I couldn't I couldn't find any detail about the SFMC marketing arms. So my personal opinion is they would have done some marketing at least to sell the excess production at a loss even to survive the plant, to survive this project. They could have done, but there's no evidence to see that. Apart from two shipments which had gone to Burma, 40,000 tons to Burma. That time they tried that, but didn't work, and up to date the payment not done. And technology trend analysis. Now, let me take you through the technology part of the technology transfer aspects of this project. They acquired the stemming carbon CO2 stripping process technology, and in 1974, they discussed about this in 1974. Whereas that time, there are two main processes. One is the stemming carbon process, and the other one is the TEC process, access TEC process. There are two main technologies available that time. And we know this is a little bit of a theory of the technology transfer. This is what you call the technology S-curve. This is very common thing to understand. And when you do a project like this, when you analyze a project like this, when you go for a future project, you have to think of the technology S-curve. Because what is S-curve? You have all these technologies will pass through these S-curves. That is what people have found. So embryonic space, where you do all this R&D work and innovations coming in, and the growth phase, developing prototypes, and mature phase, improving the reliability, and aging, where you reap the harvest of this season. But when are you now, if you are going to buy the technology from a country, from an organization, you have to think, you have to analyze and see where this technology lies in the S-curve. Is it in the embryonic phase, growth phase, or mature phase, or aging phase? So these are the two main technologies available that time, right? So all these two main technologies started in R&D work started in 1940, but that has a very long history, as Mr. Welheng explained to you. Then eventually they also, time to time, these two licensors, they evolved this process. It was started in 1948, the first plant construction, and this one, semi-carbon process, started in 1956. Then 1960 they innovated, then 1996. See, 1996 they changed, they had an innovation to the same technology. They improved it, 1996. Urea 2000 plus TM. Plus, that was the name they had given to this process. So they have different names given. So time to time, they realize the drawbacks and they put a lot of innovations into their processes, right? Likewise, access process, other process also, the 96 there then some innovations, 83 there's a change, 99 there's a change, and 2002 recently they have done another change, CSTR model, continuous stirred reactors, and revamping in 2002. There are a lot of companies did a revamping because the licensees, the people who are running the plant, when there is a change in the process, advancement, they acquire the advancements. Otherwise, you can't survive. This is the game. And there are, these are the advancements, technological advancements. Time to time, there are changes in the process. 1960s process, total recycle B process, this is the TEC. Urea process, one of these, there are two, semi-carbon and TEC. This is about the TEC development after 1960s up to 2000 and today. So time to time there are developments coming in. That is what we can see, that is what we can realize. And first they want to minimize the ammonia consumption, then they want to minimize the energy utilization, and then pollution prevention and product quality improvement. And finally, the plant cost reduction. So now they are focusing on reducing the total plant cost. And see how they have reduced the pressure. Then he mentioned 250 bars required or 400 centigrade required to perform the Haber-Bosch reaction. But later on, they have reduced the pressure it has become 155 bars from 250, and power consumption 140 kilowatt to 118 kilowatts per metric ton. So time to time that has been evolved, and these are the licensing rate. So there are two main technologies. You see there are two curves in this graph, right? This is the stemicarbon licensing. That is where, I mean, the number of plants installed based on stemicarbon, otherwise number of plants installed on TEC process. See, 1960s TEC process was very popular, and 1970s stemicarbon was popular. Maybe there is a reason our decision makers went to stemicarbon based plant. And technological capabilities, another aspect. Technological capabilities is also a big question, big issue in this project, as I see. To establish a plant like this, this is a heavy chemical processing plant. We need certain capabilities to acquire the technology, to maintain it and run this plant. These are some of them are acquiring technologies, converting technologies, vending technologies, like that. And this is my the matrix that I developed for a nation to have to transfer a technology like this, a plant like this, successfully. You have to have certain set of capabilities to run a plant like this, to acquire technology like this, to absorb this kind of a plant. Otherwise, it become a failure. We have conversion capabilities. Conversion capabilities, what you do, you convert the raw material into product. You have to have certain knowledge. I'm not going in detail about it. There are so many things to discuss about that, but conversion technology. Capabilities, acquiring capabilities, how you acquire the technology. This is the stemicarbon CO2 process technology. How do you acquire that? You have the knowledge to acquire that, you have the power, absorption power to take that. The people who run, the people, the decision makers, the operators, the staff, the maintenance crew, do they have that capability? A vending capability, of course, not required for a plant, because we are not selling plants. Modifying capabilities, yes, we need to some extent modifying capabilities, because time to time these plants, these technologies evolve with certain innovations coming in, as I showed you right now. So we have the capacity to acquire them financially and technically. And generating capabilities, of course, not required, it is zero. So that diagonal shows where you have to have these capabilities. At what extent you need these capabilities? So generating capabilities to generate technologies. Of course, it's not required to run the plant. The mechanical issues we had: CO2 compressor failure, raw water intake pump failure. Correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Pelenge, who is one of the plant engineers who was running there. F1 basin pump vibration issue. Clarified immunizer instrument issues, electrical switch gear problems, boiler feed pump failure, turbo generator failure, naphtha tank pump failure, acid pump failure, nitrogen expansion turbine failure, NHT transfer pump failure, replaced pump. Some of them are replaced. We are talking about this 3 years time. Actually, most of them happened during the commissioning period. That is the most interesting thing. 5 month delay in steam supply delayed the commissioning period. 5 months could not supply the steam. Process air compressor alignment failure, recycled hydrogen compressor issues, urea pill section, centrifugation, instrumentation issues. So there are numerous mechanical issues. This is connected to my so-called technological capabilities. Why I want to show this list of issues? Because this shows we haven't had technological capabilities required to absorb this much of this scale plant, to run the scale plant. Production history, of course, we show this. Why this production? Again, I am showing the same slide. Why? Some days, some months, hardly any production. Plant down because of these so-called mechanical failures. Power and energy source. There was a 6 megawatt generator and the CB supply, right? Now, to run the plant, 6 megawatt is okay. Out of the 6 megawatt, 3.4 megawatt is essential. Where I rightly mentioned something you can't, some parts you can't stop. So 3.4 is essential. Balance, you can switch off and switch on. But to start up, you need the CEB support, CEB supply. But in Sri Lanka, you know, CEB reliability at that time, in fact, that time particularly, CEB reliability was, you know, out of the case, right? So because of these power failures, plant shut down suddenly. You imagine to start again, it takes 6 months, 6 days, and it costs a lot of money. That time, I think it's they need for 1 week 28 million rupees to start up. That time in 1976, millions. That time for 1 week. Energy supply, so dependability on the natural grid, costly in-house generation, because you have to in-house generation is, if the plant is shut down, no steam. But steam is there, of course you don't want fuel to run the generator, right? Now that the case is plant is shut down, you have to have fuel to start the this thing. Startup loading, breakdowns, energy. So we have to focus on energy efficient technologies, decentralized versus centralized plants. So I propose not one big plant, centralized small plants. I propose not parallel operation versus single line. I propose parallel operation, not single line. Single line plants for Sri Lanka, for countries like this part of the world is not suitable. For Germany, yes, but Sri Lanka, no. Master slave concepts versus single large units. We had one single CO2 compressor. If the compressor fails, entire plant down. I propose master slave concepts. One compressor, master, and there are other compressors, slaves. When there is a demand, other compressors come out, right? So if one compressor is down, you have other compressors running. You can run the plant at a lower level. So these are the concept that suits for countries like us, for domains like us. The terminology is domain. In technology terms, it calls domain. For these kind of domains, these are the concepts. Master flexibility. So we must think of dual fuel, alternative fuels. If one fuel is scarce, because as I showed, the fuel prices are highly related to world politics. If something is wrong in Samya, in Middle East, or Russia, or Samya, the price goes up. World oil crisis and world politics. In fact, we discuss about this. And this is one of the things, SFMC versus CFC. Now, SFMC is State Fertilizer Manufacturing Corporation. This is Urea project. CFC is Colombo Fertilizer Corporation. It's another entity, right? Another entity. CFC started importing urea that time. SFMC started making urea here. So there's a conflict in between these two entities. So there's no control because of the political agendas, different people have different agendas, there's no control over that. So there's a rivalry in between two entities, which was very unfortunate thing happened to SFMC. Selection of appropriate technology. The main issue with the technology is energy utilization and source of energy supply to the plant. Running a single on-site generator is very risky, as I told you. But due to the startup of heavy machinery, SFMC could not use smaller generators for the energy supply. The national grid power supply is the supplier for them. SFMC could have included decentralized energy requirements, as I explained to you. Selection of appropriate technology. Techno-economic compatibility criteria. Now, if one wants to select the right technology for countries like us, we have to think of these three mandatory: techno-economic compatibility, organizational compatibility, operating domain compatibility. The techno-economic is economics. We have to have a proper analysis, proper projection for the next decade, next two decades of the economics. And organization compatibility, where if this organization is, whether this organization is capable to run this show. There was 1,267 staff SFMC had, 1,267 staff. Right, operating domain compatibility. Now we are operating the generation. This technology was generated in Germany. This was the contractor was Kellogg's from USA. This is installed in Sri Lanka. So Sri Lanka is a domain. What are the domain concerns? What are the environmental concerns here? I'm not talking about the environment, the ecologic environment. I'm talking about the economic environment of Sri Lanka. Can we produce with naphtha? Can we produce with something else? What is the naphtha price? From where we are getting the naphtha? Is it directly related to the world crude oil price? So these are all domain issues. Even today we are struggling. Incremental innovations, energy conservation modifications, conversion. Now, these things, a transferee should be aware of and should be able to adopt the time-to-time modifications, as I explained earlier. Energy conservative modifications, cost-efficient related modifications, capacity-related modification, raw material-related. Why I'm talking about the raw material? Because time-to-time you have to change the raw material. Now, what has happened to naphtha process eventually become natural gas process. Now, nobody uses naphtha. Everybody uses what? Can somebody say? What do you use today for urea production? Some LPG, but now people are moving to coal. Coal. You know coal is there, everybody knows that coal is there, now cheapest. Everybody moving to coal. So if we have the plant today, we had it. So we should be able to change over to coal now, feedstock from naphtha. Policy implications. So I don't want to tell you about policy situation, which is very, very obvious. Sri Lanka, when the government changes, policy changes, right? Economic policies of a country changes with the government. And inter-cooperation harmony, there's no inter-cooperation harmony. That's also a problem. And private sector participation and tax mechanisms have to be manipulated to encourage the manufacturing in Sri Lanka. Today's context, particularly I want to show you this one of the last slides, the China, what is happening in China today. They have oversupply, the market rate is $177 per ton, and coal price has been declined drastically. And 2016, still they have plants coming up. Right, feedstock with high energy efficiency plants. Chinese government has liberalized the export policy. Now they are exporting urea. Therefore, the world market price has come down. That is why the world market is now dropping, because China is now exporting urea, and they have 70% of their plants based on coal and 30% based on natural gas, and no naphtha based plants now. Anthracite is the most widely used feedstock, that is type of coal, but now the anthracite is very expensive. It is used for other processes, therefore now they use lignite and bituminous coal. So today's context, this is one of the paper extract that I got. I saw most of our decision makers do not realize that taking laboratory innovations to commercial levels need transfer of technology, transfer of innovative and proven technology, foreign capital, secure markets for finished products, stable investment and regulatory regime. There are four things that this author wants to highlight, right? So I talked to you about the transfer of innovative and proven technology part of it, but there are certain other things we have to look into, which are mostly related to economics. So I recommend when we go for international technology transfers like this, we have to have a set of national rules to enforce decision makers to follow in the case of national projects. There must be a set of national rules, including technology trend analysis, selection of appropriate technology, acquiring the technological capabilities, economic plan sizing, and with solid government policies, the stable government policies, right? Without, I mean, these guidelines should inbuilt resistance to political influence. We have to have something like in USA, their president changed, but nothing will happen to the national policies. Likewise, we have to have some sort of mechanism in place where that has a resistance to influence of politicians. So that's it about my presentation. Now, before you ask questions from me, I want you to answer my questions in a small paper because there may be very many correct answers. I want to give only two people two gifts. Please send me your answer now. Remember my question: what was the crucial factor that was affecting the failure of this project? There are very many things I highlighted, but the most crucial factor, I want the most crucial factor, right? Think carefully and write and give it to me.
How many minutes you have?
I will give 5 minutes. Two porcelain tea sets, Noritake porcelain tea sets. You also can participate the competition, no problem. after this. Right. Anybody from LAUGFS is not, no, you all can, you all are students, it's okay. But LAUGFS permanent employees are excluded. You can. You are a AFCAS employee. What do you think the most crucial factor that contributed to the failure of this project? I mentioned various factors. One basic factor, which is the number one factor. There are all factors contributing to this, but the most important factor or the crucial factor.